I tell you right now, that's good. Amen. You know, I'm glad to have the assurance of that promise. I mean, when this life is over and when it's finished, I am, as old saying goes, I am out of here. Amen. Well, great job this morning. Bless my soul, it did. It's good to see everybody this morning. I'm glad that you're here today, and I'm glad you're tuning in live stream. Looking forward to what God has for us today. I want to, just as a way of reminder, as we get started this morning, I want to remind everybody to continue to remember Miss Irma. Miss Irma certainly stands in need of our prayers today. And also, if you will, remember Miss Doris. Miss Doris got put in the hospital yesterday, and I talked to Kay last night, and she said that they moved her up onto the fourth floor and told them it would be a few days before they could come and visit. So please be praying for them. Be praying for Mr. Jesse. And just asking God to touch them. Also, remember Melba's sister. She is real low. Her name is Joyce. Please be lifting her up for the Lord. They turned her over to hospice this week. So a lot of things to be praying for. Remember our community. Remember our country. There's been a lot of things happened in 2020. I don't know. I saw on Facebook somebody posted the other day and said, won't you be glad to say goodbye to 2020? No, that's wishing your life away is what my mama always said. I just pray that 2020 gets better from here on out. Amen. With God in control, it'll be just like he wants it. But anyway, it's good to have everybody here, and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for being with us today. Thank you for all the love you show us, and God, just for strengthening us and upholding us with your right hand of righteousness. I pray today for each one it's my duty to pray for. And Lord, there's a whole list of folks on our prayer list. These are certainly some troubling and trying times, but God, you are faithful. And Lord, you tell us to cast every care we have upon you. And Lord, take your yoke upon us, for your burden is light. God, I ask you now to help us, strengthen us, be with us in the service today. And God, I pray that everything it's said, everything it's done will lift you up. And Lord, I believe in that you said when you said that when you are lifted up, you'll draw all men unto yourself. I'm a believing you to do that this morning, to draw men and women, boys and girls, to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ today, as we, in our feeble attempts, lift you up. We love you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Megan.
Amen. Oh, excuse me. All right. This morning, I'll be singing Good, Good Father by Chris Tomlin.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love at the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father.
Amen. Yes, he is.
It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I see many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are, it's who you are. can hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still into love, 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 your good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am, it's who I am, your good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am, your good, good Father. Who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am, your good. You are perfect in all of your ways.
It's who you are, and I'm loved.
You are perfect in all of your ways. Who I am.
Amen.
He is a good, good Father. Praise the Lord. Hey, I wanted to also let you know, if I could, that we are starting now our Annie Armstrong Christmas offering that goes to the International Mission Board. So everybody, these pamphlets up inside. Also, we have envelopes. If anybody feels led to give to the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. Listen to that, Christmas offering. Feel free. There's, like I said, I have the envelopes and all for that down here. A lot of people's lives are being touched through the work that you do by giving to that good need. Have your Bibles with you this morning. Turn with me to Romans chapter number 6. Romans chapter number 6. And could I borrow your book, please? That wind just keeps wanting to blow my pages, and I keep forgetting to get something to hold them in place. Romans chapter number 6. We are actually going to start reading, if we can, this morning. And, let's back up and let's start reading in verse number 14. And today I want to bring you a message. As I said before, this is finding God for all by myself, all for myself, or all by myself. And today we were going to deal with the fact that we do not have a license to sin. There is a passage of Scripture that Paul speaks about that he says when he would do good, the good that he would do, that he did not, but that he wouldn't do, that he did. He also said when he do good, there was always, he saw another law and within his members. He always, as much as he tried to be good, he always had sin lurking at the door, if you will. There's a lot of us that buy into the idea that just because we still live in this world that we've got a license to sin. Well, you say, well, Brother Mark, I would never think that. Well, when we have our pet little sins, my friends, we have bought into that idea. What's a pet sin? That's that sin that you keep tucked down inside of your heart, that one that you don't think nobody knows about, that one little infraction that you got that you know that doesn't exactly line up with the Word of God, but you continue therein anyway. Starting now in Romans 6:14, with that being said, listen to these words. For sin... What? Sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. What then? Shall we sin because we're not under the law but under grace? God forbid. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourself servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness? But God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered unto you, delivered you, being then made free from sin, ye become the servants of righteousness. I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh. For as ye have yielded your members servants to uncleanliness and to iniquity, even so now yield your members servants to righteousness unto holiness. For when you were the servants of sin, you were free from righteousness. What fruit had ye then in those things whereof ye are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. But now being made free from sin and become the servants to God, ye have your fruit unto holiness, and the end everlasting life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Heavenly Father God, I pray right now that you would take this portion of thy word, saturate it in our hearts. Help us to be more like you from it. Help us to learn that what you'd have us to learn, and we'll praise you for a changed life. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, first thing that I want us to think about as we start to look at this and is the fact that a believer is not to continue in sin. A believer is not to continue in sin. Brother Mark, you believe that a person can live without sin? No, but I think he ought to try to. Amen? I believe that he ought to try to live without sin. You see, you and I, when we look at this passage of Scripture, I want you to understand that many of us have the idea, even as Christians today, that there's certain things that sin just still dominates in our life. For instance, our anger. Sin still dominates our anger. Friends, sin should not dominate our anger because the Bible says, and it being the Word of God, and I believe it to be true. How about you? You believe the Bible to be true? Blow your horn if you do. Well, if you believe the Bible to be true, the Bible says that for you and I should be angry and sin not. Friends, I got news for you. There's something inside of us that will cause us to buy into the idea when we're angry, we can say anything we want to say, do anything we want to do, and then turn our face toward heaven and say, God forbid, forgive, please. Friends, I don't want you to know, I understand that it does not work this way. And I want to stand before you today and throw my hand up and say, you know what, from time to time, I have been guilty of that. I have been guilty of that. So I want you to understand, the Bible says for a Christian, and as Paul writes to the Romans here, it says, for sin shall not have dominion over you. It shouldn't control you. It should not dominate your life. Now, I want you to understand, as he's writing to the Romans understood law. They understood that you lived within a certain set of guidelines, and as long as you lived within a certain set of guidelines, everything was all right. Now, had they been living under the law of God, then they would have to adhere to certain things. And as long as they adhered to those things, they were without sin. But when they broke one of those things, they became sinful. Well, isn't that how it works? Yes, Brother Mark, that's how it works. But I want you to understand, when a person was under the law and they're just living by a set of rules that they're following, my friend, as long as they stay within those rules, there is absolutely no need of grace, and there would have been no need for Christ going to the cross. But, friends, they are a thing called grace that releases us from that law. It releases us because we had trouble staying there, but at the same time, we have trouble staying there, living within those means, but at the same time, we must understand that sin should not have dominion over us. See, the person under the law is always struggling, trying to keep the law. You ever tried to live within a bunch of rules? You know, you take old Adam and Eve over in the garden. God told them, says, hey, you're free to do anything you want to. And he gave them one rule. Of the tree in the midst of the garden, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, he said, of all the trees in the garden, you can eat of all of them freely. Have as much as you want. But that one tree, leave it alone. Leave that fruit alone. That belongs to me. What did they do? They said, well, rules is made to be broken. So what's the first thing that they did? And the first thing they did, they went and the devil just slid in there and made a few suggestions to them. And what did they do? Man, they eat it and it caused the fall of humanity. Friends, I got news for you. As we look at this passage of Scripture and we think about that person that's under that law, my friends, we many times feel like that rules is just something made to be broken. If we were under the law, my friends, I want you to know it causes a struggle within us. As we find ourselves trying to follow a strict set of rules, we find that there's constantly a struggle all the time. Well, did I mess up? Did I go too far this way? Did I infraction that law too much? Am I in trouble with the Father? Is he fixing to scold me? Oh my, if I died right in this moment? Did you know there's a lot of denominations out there that believe if you have sin in your life and you die, then you've lost your salvation and you go immediately to hell. Well, it's not true. Because here's the thing, when we start to look at that, I want you to see that struggle that's within them. The person under the law never lives a victorious life. He's constantly coming short of God's glory and God's perfection. And when he fails, he goes through periods of self-accusation, of reproaching and censoring himself and trying his best to. Do you understand how that a person is pressed down trying to live within a set of rules? Sure you can. It's not hard to see. So here's something that I want you to learn. We're under grace. And being under grace, it is important for us to understand that God is not a legal judge hovering over the believer waiting to punish him every time he sins. God is not looking to you for sinless perfection. God's looking to you for the blood of Jesus Christ applied to your life. God is looking to you to be made righteous by the goodness of Christ, not by our own goodness. Well, does that give us a license to sin? Well, the Scripture says here in Romans chapter 6, it says this, what then shall we sin? Because we're not under the law, but under the grace? The Bible is clear. God forbid. A Christian is not supposed to live a life of sin. A Christian should not allow sin to reign in his mortal bodies. If you were to go back in chapter 6 and we were to look, starting in verse 11, it says, likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. And because we're dead to our sin, and because we're alive through Jesus Christ, verse 12 of chapter 6 says, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in the lust thereof. We've heard it said so many times before that sin will carry you farther than you want to go and keep you longer than you want to stay. Well, I want to submit to you, it will beat you up worse than you want to be beat on. I want you to understand this. A true believer, my friend, is not dominated by sin in his life. You shouldn't let it reign in our body. Do you remember when you got saved? God wiped your slate clean. It was washed away. All your sin. When you ask God to forgive you of those sins, 1 John 1:9 is true. And when we said that if we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He wiped it clean. And my friend, we died to ourselves, and we have a wonderful, loving Heavenly Father who paid it all for us. And therefore, my friend, because God loves us, and as all that he has done for us, we, the Bible says the first commandment is to love the Lord thy what did it say? To love the Lord thy God with all of thy heart. Why shouldn't we allow sin to reign if we got a free license to sin? Because we love the Father. That's why we shouldn't sin. Because we have the love of God within us. We love him and we want to please him. Have you ever done something because you wanted to please somebody? I remember when I was a little boy, I'm going to tell you right now, I worshipped my daddy. I did. I thought my daddy could walk on water. I thought he was all that in a bag of chips. I did. Still do today. Amen? But I remember as a 11 and 12-year-old boy, we had chicken houses, and I'm going to tell you what I'd do. I'd wake up early in the morning. I still do. Amen? I'd wake up early in the morning, and I would walk out to our chicken houses, and when I'd get out there to the chicken house, I didn't go in my truck that Daddy'd already give me because it'd wake them up, but I'd slip out to the chicken houses, and we'd have little baby chickens, and I'd go, and I'd work like fighting the fire for a couple of hours trying my best to get all the chickens fed, all the waters washed and filled up and everything, have everything done by the time my mom and my daddy woke up. You know why? Because I sought to please my Father. And you know what? Sin shouldn't have dominion over a Christian today, because what we ought to do is we ought to seek to please our Father. You and I, my friends, we go around and we act sometimes like we just can't help ourselves. The Bible says plainly in verse 14 that sin should not have dominion over you. So know this, my friend, as a Christian, sin should not dominate you and cause you to live contrary to the Word of God, because you are a child of God and you have the love of God within you, and you should not let it dominate. Now, I want you to see this as we go down through here. But you know this. Look at verse 16. Know ye not that to whom you yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom you obey. Even though you've been bought by the blood, and even though you are trusting Christ for salvation throughout eternity, for you, my friend, to obey the lust of sin in your life, you are a servant still of the devil. You can be a Christian and you can serve Satan real well. Let me give you an example of that. A lot of times in times past, I don't know how it's going to be when we come out of this COVID things, but a lot of times in times past, we have seen people within the church that had a problem, not just this church, it's all church, it is church. A lot of people have a problem with others in the church, and what do? They run them down. They talk about them. They do all manner of ungodly things that causes bitterness and strife. They sow discord among the brethren. They talk about they again everything that's trying to go on. They got a problem with everything that everybody else is doing. Sally wears the wrong color of pants to church, and everybody's got a problem. Bill, he come in here, and I know where he was at last night, and I got a problem with him, and you know, you get the point. The Bible teaches us that we're supposed to walk together in unity, and when a brother's overtaken in a fault, we are to restore such a one. Beware lest you fall into the same divers temptations, according to Galatians chapter 6. But our problem is the fact that in times past, we have served Satan by sowing the discord among the brethren within the doors of the church. There's been many a good people that have walked away from God, that have walked away from serving him, has left the church because of good people who have been saved was serving Satan within the church. You say, how do you see that, Brother Mark? Stand in my position a little while. You'll see it real good. You do everything you can to build something up. 5 minutes, people tear it down. You spend months trying to get something implemented. You spend years trying to get something to put together. And in one day, people can destroy it. Let Satan get in them and use them. We shouldn't serve sin, is what Scripture says. Let's see what else it says down through here. I'm going to try to hurry, amen? I know y'all ready for me to hurry, amen? Listen to this. So know this. You can only serve one master. You can either serve sin and Satan, or you can serve God. You can't serve them both. It's absolutely an improbability. Impossibility. An improbable impossibility. Listen to this. I want you to understand that as a Christian, a person is either a slave of sin or a slave to God. And it's a very simple test to tell which one you are. Listen to this. Do you yield to sin, that is, serve sin? Have you yielded yourself to do right, or do you yield yourself to serve sin? I'm amazed at how many of these young people have been taught to serve sin. My Bible teaches me that as a Christian, that I'm supposed to be a peacemaker. Isn't that what it teaches? As a peacemaker, I want you to understand, running your smart mouth is not a peacemaker. You see, a lot of young people today have been taught by their older parents that they have a voice and a right to be able to say anything that they want to say. My friends, if it is causing division among the brethren, the Bible teaches us that that is sin. There's too many people today that just teaching their kids, you need to say what you want to say. I'm going to pick on Jaden. He's mine. I can pick on him if I can. I want you to understand something. I was walking through the shop the other night, and as we were walking through there, I told Jaden, I said, I'm going to have to get my grandboys up here and help me sweep out my shop. And old Jaden is right behind me. He's older, muttered under his breath. He said, you need to hire somebody to do that. You know how that went over? I didn't say a word. But the word ain't over yet. Amen? See, if I'd have said something like that, I wouldn't have had no teeth. It wasn't false. Amen? Do you understand what I'm saying? Now I ain't saying and Jaden is a good kid. Don't get me wrong. But, friends, I want you to know something. When it causes derision, that could have been said in a little different context within the walls and the confines of the church. And you know what happened? Split. The Bible teaches us plainly down here that we cannot serve God and serve sin at the same time. So ask yourself, do you yield yourself to sin, that is, to serve sin, or do you yield yourself to God, that is, to serve God? If you yield to sin, the Bible says you'll die. You say, how do you know that? Listen to this. To whom you yield yourselves, verse 16, servants to obey, his servants ye are, to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. Friends, when we serve sin, I got news for you. Sin will cause death, spiritual death. Look at verse number 17, if you will. I want you to understand this. First of all, I want you to, as I said, I want you to know something. Now I want you to remember something. I want you to remember your decision. But God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin, but you have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered to you. I want you to remember who you now serve. When sin starts to come up, and it will come up, Satan's good at his job, and he will entice you, and he will send people in your path to tick you off and to make you mad, and you know what? He'll put it out there, and you'll have to make a decision in that moment just exactly who you serve. I'm afraid to say sometimes I fail miserably. But at the same time, it's not the normal. It shouldn't happen regularly. Now look at here. I want you to know, believers who were the servants of sin, they used to yield themselves to sin, all kinds of sin, ranging from simple off-color jokes using God's name in vain, immoral thoughts of adultery, simple thoughts of pride to drunkenness, simple acts of selfishness and stealing, wanting more to actually indulging themselves in too much, sin of seeking position and power over hurting and crushing people. That's how we used to serve sin. But when we believed on Jesus Christ, we no longer let sin reign. R-E-I-G-N. That means we don't let it have dominion over us. We don't let it have dictatorship over us. We do not let it control us anymore. Verse 14, we don't let it have dominion over us anymore. It's easy to serve sin. It's easy to yield ourselves to things in this world. But the Christian life is a disciplined life. I find out through my own life, as long as I'm reading my Bible, seeking Him, as long as I'm on my knees, daily praying, seeking His face, as long as I am active in my church, as long as I am conducting myself as best as I can, making every decision, bringing every thought into the captivity of Christ, bringing every thought up against the Word of God before I act upon it, I find that sin does not dominate me. But when I start to leave off my Bible reading, when I stop praying the way that I did, when I stop fellowshipping the way that I used to fellowship, when I start to live back out in the world rather than living in the community of God, I find that I start to let sin dominate me again. And sin will cause spiritual death. Let me explain this and I'm going to hush. Sin, though it cannot, after you've truly been born again, it cannot rob you of salvation. Sin can certainly take away the joy thereof. I talked with a man not long ago, and this man and his wife had been in church, and they had was serving the Lord, and everything was going good. He talked about how great and wonderful life was. But then he let temptation come in. And in a moment of weakness, he had an affair. A one-time encounter, a one-night stand, if you will. But the first thing that happened was it destroyed his marriage. And when it destroyed his marriage, it destroyed her relationship with God. After all, he was supposed to be the head of the family. He was supposed to be seeking God for the family. Not only did it destroy her relationship with the Lord, but it destroyed his relationship with the Lord because he quit praying. He quit reading the scripture. He quit going to church. What would them people at the church think? He allowed it all just to fall completely apart. And he was totally away from God. He was still saved. She was still saved. But both of them had met spiritual death because sin had been allowed to reign, take control, and have lordship over his life. Now, your sin may not be near that big of a deal in your eyes. You might not have had an adulterous affair. You might not have went out and murdered somebody. You might not have done something so heinous as that. But friends, I got news for you. As God looks down from his lofty throne, all sin destroys. All sin has a way of bringing spiritual death into our lives. I, myself, personally, I'm like the psalmist David. I mess up a lot. But, like David, I try to go to my knees regularly. When I realize that sin has taken control, I take a moment and I quickly beg God, number one, to forgive me. Because my sin wasn't against anybody else. My sin was against him. And when I do that, what I'm actually doing is I'm stopping the dominion that sin has over me in that moment. It's what all of us should do. So maybe right where you are today, maybe you're at home, sin has been reigning in your life. You've noticed it. It's come in with off-color words. It's come in with thoughts that you wasn't having 6 months, a year ago. It come in through somebody else that has brought in bitterness into your life and done something, and bitterness has taken over and taken control. I don't know what yours is. But what I do know, if you leave it alone, it'll spiritually kill you. But we've got a God who wants to hear. And he wants us to confess. So this morning, right where you are, whether you're here or whether you are there at the watching live stream, why not just right where you are, just bow your head with me and say, Lord Jesus, I've allowed sin to come in. And I've allowed it to take over in a lot of areas of my life. Would you forgive me? Would you create within me, as the psalmist David said, a clean heart? I don't have a license to sin just because I'm saved. What I do have is a new life to live devoted to you. Forgive me, wash me clean, restore me, because I know the gift you give to me is eternal life, and I want to serve you. In Jesus' name, amen. Maybe you prayed that with me this morning. They're fixing to have a song just in a second from my inside. If you wanted to come and stand, if you're here and pray, you can. If you would like me to pray with you, I'd love to do that. Just whatever we need to do. Maybe there's something else that's on your heart and you had nothing to do with the sermon this morning and you wanted to pray about it. You just come forward and as we do the invitation. At home, maybe you have prayed this morning and you'd like to share that with someone. If you go to our website, centralhatchiefirstbaptist.com, go down through there and you'll see a place where you can click on prayers, and you can put it there, and that'll come straight to my office. Nobody else will see that. Come straight to my computer. I'd love to have a record of the fact that you have prayed, and I'd like to have the opportunity to minister to you, if at all possible. So as they play the song, whatever you need to do, would you just be obedient to the Lord?
finding myself at a loss for words. And the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, hear your voice. Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, hear your voice. My eyes to see your
He's here this morning. Can you feel him? Amen. God is good. Praise the Lord. Thank y'all for being here today. I just want you to know, church, that I love you. I thank you for being here at our 9 o'clock service. And just to let you guys know where you can let other people know, we are going to continue on doing the drive-in service. Well, that's not going to change. We're going to keep doing this. But I need you also to know that the first Sunday in December, we're going to be going back into the sanctuary. We're going to be going back just like what we have been in the past. We're still going to enter going up the ramp. We're going to come out over here on this side. We're not starting Sunday school yet. We're going in just exactly the way that we are. And we'll see how that goes. On that same day, we were going to be having our Christmas and Thanksgiving meal. We're going to cook it. We're going to prepare it here. There'll be just it will not be a covered dish. We'll be doing it. I'll get a certain number of folks. It causes for less exposure, and then we'll have the table set socially distanced in the fellowship hall. We'll be following the protocol of COVID. We'd love to have you to be there for that, if at all possible. It's going to be a good time in the Lord. And even if it's a pretty and a warm day, hey, we may even set a few tables out here somewhere where some of us can sit outside if it's a pretty warm day. You notice what I said, if it's a pretty warm day. But anyway, I love you. Thank you for being here today. God bless you. Well, Heavenly Father, God, thank you for the spirit we felt in this place today. Help us, God, to be more like you in every way. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless. Thank you for being here.